Which most of you probably won't even have to turn. But I'll be coming from the third chapter of John, and we'll be going from the first through the 18th verse. But I'm just going to read just one verse this morning, because that is the verse that we're focusing on this morning. John 3:16. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, I come this morning, and I come, Father, thanking you for the privilege to stand before your people this morning. Lord, I ask you that you would please let your Holy Spirit use me in whatever way he sees fit, and that I will be obedient. Bless this congregation who's listening this morning, and Lord, bless me. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I realize that this being the first Sunday of the month officially designated in America as Black History Month, and the Sunday that we celebrate the Lord's Supper, that usually there are certain sermons that we preach, and usually they are not John 3:16. But it was a little tough making a decision on my text for today. I considered several passages that I thought would reflect upon the Black experience in America as compared to the plight of the Israelites or the Hebrews or the Jews, whichever you desire to call them, because they had several names just like we've had. Nigger, Negro, Black American, African American, whatever. But in the Jews in different nations, but none of them were what the Holy Spirit wanted me to bring to you today. And we will celebrate the Lord's Supper no matter what text I preach from anyway. What the Holy Spirit kept bringing back to me every time I began to study for today was John 3:16, the most popular and most quoted verse in the scriptures. However, it is also probably the most misunderstood verse in the scriptures. And he wants to shed some light on it today. I will use as a subject today, look up on me and live. No doubt there are some sitting here today who can quote the verse John 3:16 without a second thought. Probably most of us, even the children, but at the same time, for one reason or other, don't feel that God loves them. For God so loved the world, but there are so many that just don't feel loved. Well, it is important to God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit that you leave here today without a doubt in your mind that the whosoever in John 3:16 includes you if you believe. I've got to get some. Could I get some water, please? My mouth is real dry. In our text today, it begins shortly after Jesus went to Jerusalem for the celebration of the Passover and cleaned the temple out, y'all. He went in there and they were doing all kind of stuff in the temple, selling stuff, using God's house for everything except what God's house is supposed to be used for. Now, don't you know that God has his house for particular reasons? It is not a house of merchandise. When Jesus came to Jerusalem that day and went into the temple, they were selling all kinds of stuff, and it, some of the stuff they needed to be selling, because people would come from long distances and they would need to buy things for their sacrifice. But the ones that were selling it were getting over, like what we say, fat rats. They were selling at such exorbitant prices, and they were causing a burden for the people that came to Jerusalem so that they could worship in the temple and celebrate the Passover. Thank you, Cynthia. And they were being charged these exorbitant prices for these things, and some of them bought their sacrifices with them, and there was nothing wrong with their sacrifices. But those that were there in the temple doing the selling would say that this was wrong with it or that was wrong with it, so they would have to buy something to sacrifice. Well, Jesus came in and he was upset, and he took a whip. He made a whip, and he ran all of them out. He threw tables over and all. He was angry. He was upset because he saw his Father's house being used for something that God never intended for it to be used for. Now, many of the people that were there had believed in his name, but it was only because of the miracles that they had seen him do. How many of you know that Jesus doesn't want us to just love him only because of what we have done, he has done for us? He doesn't want us to just love him because of miracles. He doesn't want us to just love him just because he healed us when we were sick, or because he supplied a need that we had when we were in need, or because he gave us that job that we were praying for. He wants us to love him and to worship him because of who he is and because of what he has already done for us over 2,000 years ago. So Jesus was very upset. And then he didn't really take too much to these people that said that they loved him, because he knew what their motives were. He knew that the only reason that they believed in him was because of those miracles that he had worked. And then there were those that still hated him. You see, the Pharisees were very jealous of Jesus because Jesus was getting too much attention. People were paying attention to him because of his miracles and because of his teaching, because of things that he did that they could not do. And before Jesus came on the scene, they were the ones that were looked up to. You know, they were the ones that had the education. They were the ones that had the status. They were the ones, most of them, like Nicodemus, were wealthy. And so they did not like the fact that Jesus was now getting attention that they felt they were supposed to get. And you know, there are some of us today that are still that same way. They're all right with you. They like you and all that. You can be their friend. You can be their pastor. You can be whatever it is, unless you are getting more attention than they get. Unless someone sees you as a better person, a better preacher, a better teacher, or whatever it is that would make you stand out as ahead of them. And it's not only that way in the church, but we as a people, y'all, we cannot stand to see one of us get ahead of us. Now, we talk about celebrating Black history, and yes, Black history should be celebrated. But you know what? We need some new Black history, Black people to be celebrating now. You know, we need to teach our children that they need to be people of integrity, that they need education, yes, but they don't need that education to rule their lives. They need to have Jesus first. Because of what Jesus did when he died on that cross for them, they need to put Jesus first in their lives. We have some young people, some children that are smart. They're very intelligent. They know how to do things that some of us older ones would probably never be able to do. I know that some of them I can't. But see, we need to let them know that even though you are intelligent, and that even though you know how to do a lot of things, you're very smart, that the thing you need even more than intelligence is integrity. We need to train up our children in the way that they should go, so that when they are old, they won't depart from it. You see, they can't always just piggyback off of what Martin Luther King did, or what Booker T. Washington did, or what Barack Obama was elected as the first president. They can't go by the first that everybody else became. Some of them need to be the first themselves, and they need to be the first and always with God first in their lives. So the Holy Spirit let me know that this morning that I was not to take out a subject that would fit in with Black history. This morning, he wanted me to come before you and let you know how important it is to have Jesus first in your life. It doesn't make any difference how much education you have. It doesn't make any difference how much money you have. It doesn't make any difference what things you can do or what things you cannot do. It is important that Jesus is first in your life. And please, please teach your children to have Jesus first in their lives. Now, Nicodemus, even though he was a Pharisee, he came to Jesus. He was a ruler of the Jews. He was a member of the Sanhedrin Council. He was a religious leader, and he was a teacher. But Nicodemus did not understand who Jesus was. Nicodemus did not know who Jesus was. He knew all of the Old Testament laws, and he knew the sayings of the prophets and all of this, but he still did not know who Jesus was, even after seeing all the miracles and the teachings that Jesus did. Just like some today. Now, some has all of the education. Some of them are wealthy. Nicodemus was. Some of them are great teachers. Some of them are religious leaders, even pastors of churches. But they still don't know who Jesus is. We need not be the type of people that think that just because someone can exegete the word of God, we need not think that that means that they know him. Because some people just have good memories. Some people are just smart. But the wrong kind of smartness, it doesn't help you at all when it comes to Jesus. You see, we must know Jesus in our hearts. We cannot get to Jesus through our head. It must come from our heart. He looks at the heart of man, and he can see the heart of man and know just exactly what we are thinking, what we are feeling, how we receive him or not receive him. We can fool everybody else. You see, I can come up in here and preach, and if I were smart enough, I could fool you. I thank God I'm not that smart. If I were smart enough, then I could fool you. But it doesn't make any difference how smart anyone is. It doesn't make any difference how many letters of that shows your education behind your name. It doesn't make any difference who you have connections with. It doesn't make any difference what people you have known or know now, where you work, where you went to school. None of that matters if you don't know Jesus. And that's what the situation was with Nicodemus. Nicodemus knew had all of this other stuff. And he thought he had it made, but he didn't know Jesus. So one thing about Nicodemus, though, He wasn't like some of the people that are so puffed up with pride right now in our day that they think they know it all, so they're not trying to learn from anyone else. They don't think that anybody can teach them, and if a person is not teachable, they cannot be taught. So, but Nicodemus, after hearing Jesus teach things and after seeing Jesus do miracles and all, he started to think within his heart, am I missing something? Is there something else that I need? I mean, I've got all of this education. I mean, I've been taught by the right people. I've gone to the right seminaries. All of the theological stuff there is out there to offer, I've got it. But I know that something is missing. There's something about this Jesus that I need to learn from him. So Nicodemus wanted to learn, and he came to Jesus to be taught. But he didn't want the rest of the Pharisees to know, so he waited until it got dark. I want to tell you that if you are not doing what the Holy Spirit has put up on your heart to do because you feel like the wrong person may see you doing it or the wrong person may hear you saying it, then you need to check yourself out. You see, those persons that see you doing or hear you saying have not got a heaven or a hell to put you in. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He said it himself, and he does not lie. You see, when it comes to Jesus, we have to know him in our heart. So Jesus, Nicodemus came to Jesus, and he came at night. And he came to Jesus, and he said, you know, we know that you are from God because there's no way that you could work the miracles that you work and do the things that you've done except that you come from God. And Jesus just, he just didn't even pay any attention to what he was saying that. He just went on and said, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, you must be born again. And so I can imagine Nicodemus standing there like, where is this coming from? I was just telling him how we knew he was from God, and he's telling me I must be born again. So he didn't understand this concept, but he was in the right place at the right time with the right person to tell him what that saying was. And he said that, he asked Jesus, he said, he asked Jesus, he says, how can a man be born when he is old? And Jesus said again, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, except man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Nicodemus is even more confused now. And there's still confusion on that verse. And as I have already told you, I don't claim to be smart. There's so much controversy over that particular verse. It's different ones had in different commentaries and all have different sayings about it. But then after that, the next verse after it says, that which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. It is still making a contrast and a comparison to the verse before that, that fifth verse, which said that you must be born of water and of the Spirit. Well, the word of God is given to you by the Spirit, and that is what some of the commentators say, that the word is that water. But then when it goes right back and said what is born of flesh is flesh, and which is born of the Spirit is spirit, it leads me to believe that what Jesus was telling him, you're born once because your father planted a seed into your mother, and your mother delivered you from a sack of water, and that is the way that you were born that first time. And then this birth that I'm telling you that you have to have. No man or no woman has anything to do with that. The Holy Spirit plants the seed in you. And it is up to you whether or not you are going to birth that seed. And if the Holy Spirit plants the seed into you for you to be born again, and you receive what the Holy Spirit is given unto you, and you are born again, then Jesus is telling you that this is how you are born again. He tells him that the wind blows wherever it wants to blow. And we can feel the effects of the wind, but we can never see the wind. But now when a person has been filled with the Holy Spirit, has been born again, is now a child of Jesus Christ, you should be able to see something different about that person. You should be able to feel something different when you're in that person's presence. Now, you may not know where this came from. You didn't see it when it happened. You didn't even see it when it happened to you. But you knew that something had happened. Now, Nicodemus was here with Jesus, trying to be taught by Jesus, trying to learn what Jesus was saying. He was in a state of confusion. He didn't know what was going on. But then he was teaching all of the other people what he thought he was supposed to be teaching them. But at least even though he came at night, at least Nicodemus came to Jesus. The rest of the Pharisees didn't even come. So Jesus told him that whither it goeth, so it is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Wherever the wind goeth, then you can tell that it has been there. And the same is with those that are born of the Spirit. Then Jesus goes on to say, Nicodemus goes on to say, how can this thing be? And Jesus said, man, you are a member of the Sanhedrin Council. You are a teacher of the Jews. You are a rabbi. You're one of the masters of the people, and you're telling me that you don't know these things? How many of y'all know that people can have degrees and don't know much of anything? I mean, some people spend years in seminary, going to all kind of theological schools and all. Some of them just do it on the computer, but they still get the letters behind their names when they finish, and they don't know anything about Jesus. Now, they may know some things about the world, but they don't know anything about Jesus. But only what you know about Jesus will last. So Jesus again said to him, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know and testify that we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. He's letting Nicodemus know all this stuff that you done learned and everything. And I'm telling you what I know. It's not what I read in some book or what I was taught by someone. I'm telling you what I know. And he said, and if I have told you earthly things and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you of heavenly things? You don't even understand the earthly things here on the earth where you live. And you don't understand those, and you're not believing me when I tell you. So what's the use of me telling you of heavenly things? They're much more complicated than earthly things are. So certainly you won't believe those things. And he said, if I told you earthly things and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you these heavenly things? And no man has ascended to heaven but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man. And he was talking to that person. That's who Nicodemus was talking to. And then Jesus went on to tell him about a situation back in the Old Testament, which Nicodemus should have known about because, you know, he's supposed to know all of this stuff. And he went on to tell him, Jesus went on to tell him about how the Israelites, being disobedient again to God, ended up with God having serpents to come about. And those serpents bit the people, and they were poisonous serpents. And once they bit the people, they would die. Jesus had Moses to put up a brass serpent on a pole, And Jesus let them know, and Moses let them know that if you get bitten by one of these snakes, if you look up on that brass serpent, then you won't die. And y'all, I think sometimes about the situation with the COVID that's going on now. There are so many people that come up with so many different theories as to why you shouldn't take the COVID vaccine. And I think about this passage of scripture in Numbers when I hear some of the ridiculous excuses that some of them have. Because as far as I am concerned, I feel that God made a way. And I took both of the vaccines and the booster, and if they need more boosters or whatever else they need to give, I'm taking them. I know that there is nothing about that vaccine that can do me any worse than what COVID did me. So I feel like this was something that God gave to us, and we won't, a lot of us won't accept it. So this was the same way with these Israelites. Now they've been bitten by a snake. They don't have anything to lose because they've seen everybody around them dying when they get bitten by the snake. We have seen hundreds of people that we know on a personal level die from COVID. But we still won't look to what God has said, put in place for us. So Jesus let him know that when the brass serpent was lifted up, if they looked up on that, that they would live. And Jesus was letting him know, I am going to be lifted up, and all who looks up on me shall live eternally. He went on to tell him, when the Son of Man is lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And to make sure that he really got this, he went on to the next verse, and he said it again. He said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall have everlasting life. He wanted to make sure that we understood this. He wanted to make sure that we got it. If we didn't get it in the 15th verse when he said we would have eternal life, he made sure by the next verse, maybe you'll get it in the 16th verse when he said that we would have everlasting life. And then he said God didn't send his Son into this world to condemn the world, but that the world by him might be saved. Didn't say that everyone in the world would be saved, but he did put, by him coming, he put into place the way that we could be saved. If we look upon him, we will live. Then he said that those that don't believe, that they were already condemned. You see, Jesus does not have to condemn us if we don't believe. We were born into this world already condemned. The only way that we can receive Jesus is that our hearts are open to receive him. And we receive him based on what he said and what he did to back up what he said. First, we must realize that all of mankind is lost until he accepts Jesus Christ as his Savior. He must have the righteousness of God because he has none of his own. Not any of you, not even those of you that are perfect. You don't have any righteousness of your own. We are covered by the righteousness of Jesus Christ if we accept him. Then second, we must realize that the Lord Jesus Christ loves us and gave his life for us, but he didn't make us his slaves. He won't force us or trick us into accepting him. He made us in his own likeness, which means he gave us the ability to choose right from wrong. He gave us a conscience and intelligence so we can make our own decisions about eternity. We must come to him voluntarily. Nobody's going to force you. We must be willing to serve him. He opened the door. Entering into the door is an individual choice. No one can enter for you. No one can stand on the inside and pull you in. No one can stand on the outside and push you in. Y'all, this is not a game. This is as real gets. Nothing is more real than the decision you make about Jesus Christ. The decision that you make that gives you eternal life in heaven or eternal damnation in hell. And you don't even have to make a decision to go to hell. All you have to do is not make a decision for Jesus Christ, and you will go to hell. Third, everyone who was born is lost and condemned except Jesus Christ. And we know he was born sinless. We know the only reason he was born was to die for our sins. That was the only reason he had to come here. That was the only reason Jesus was born. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, man became spiritually separated from God the Father. Everyone who has ever been born on the face of this earth except Jesus Christ was an offspring of Adam's, which means everyone was born with a sinful nature. We all have a natural desire to sin, and because of that sinful nature, we are all born spiritually separated from God. As a result of that sin, God the Son, Jesus Christ, volunteered to give up his position in heaven with God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, and the angels to be born in a human body, live here on this earth for about 33 years, and then die on the cross so that man could be restored to the spiritual fellowship with God the Father. Notice now I said could be. That means it is conditional. It's not automatic. Each individual must make the decisions for themselves. I have already told you John 3:16 is the verse everybody loves to quote. The most popular, I've told you that it is the most popular verse in the Bible. I've told you that it is the most misunderstood verse in the Bible. Because people make the mistake of thinking that God saves us because he loves us. Oh, God loves us. He loves all of us. All of us need to know and understand that God loves us. He loves those that have already accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. He loves those that have not accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. But you will not have eternity in the presence of God because he loves you. He made a way for us to be in his presence throughout eternity. It's not true that we are saved because he loves us. He provided a means of salvation because he loves us, but he saves us by grace. God loves all of us, but we won't all be saved. Unless you change that word whosoever into your name, you won't be saved. As much as God loves us and wants us to be saved, we won't be saved unless we accept Jesus Christ as the one who died on the cross for our sins and that he rose from the dead. We must believe in Christ, and we must trust in him. It is a personal thing. We are saved by grace, not by love. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. You see, if we could do it on our own, we would have a reason to boast. We would have a reason to brag. We would be walking around puffed all up with pride. But it was not because of any works that we did so that we would not be able to boast. The grace of God is something we did not and could not earn. You can't do enough work to earn grace. We are unworthy and undeserving recipients of God's favor. Grace plus nothing is the gift for your salvation. You can't add anything to that. You don't have anything to add to it. Jesus Christ died for your sins, when he rose from the dead, salvation was complete. There isn't anything else to be done. Salvation was complete when Jesus Christ rose from the dead, but it was only complete to those that accepted it. Think about someone that's in jail and they can be pardoned. Can you imagine them saying, no, I don't want to get out. I'll just stay right here. But that's exactly what we do. Jesus has died for our sins. In the pardon of our sins, he suffered and he died on that cross for us. And we walk around and say, no, I'm okay. I'll stay just as I am. Well, just as you are, if you stay just as you are, you will not spend everlasting life with Jesus. You will spend everlasting life, though. But if you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your everlasting life will be in eternal torment. God bless you. Now John 3:16.
For joining us today at Old Macedonia Baptist Church. We believe giving is a natural response for believers of Jesus Christ. We receive God's love and grace, and out of an overflow of a grateful heart, we give. We have multiple ways you can give. You can mail or drop off your tithes and offerings to 200 Macedonia Road, North Augusta, South Carolina, 298-60. You can give using the online giving feature on our website at www.oldmacedoniabc.org. Or you can download the Givelify app to your mobile device. Search for Old Macedonia Baptist Church in North Augusta, South Carolina. And don't forget to mark it as a favorite. To whom much is given, much is required. God bless.